Good morning. Welcome to worship here at the Reformed Church of Stout. A few announcements this morning just to highlight for you guys. First of all, that our fall education programs will begin on Sunday, September 12th for Sunday school and catechism classes. We'll have some special treats that day before we head off to our classrooms. Also, that our kids time activities on Wednesday night will begin on September 15th, and there's a note in the bulletin about some donations of some foods and snacks that you can give. Also, I just ask that you would tell your friends and neighbors if they have any kids that are of that age that they would come. Gwen and I are going to be gone for a couple days the end of the week, so if you need someone, let one of the elders know. Also, we have an adoption available for someone that has a good home for a loving dog. So you're saying, well, if he's so loving, why are you getting rid of him? But it's just been a little too much with our schedules and stuff. So he really is a good dog. So if you're interested, let Gwen or myself know. We've got more toys and stuff for you. You can have it all. So, okay. One more thing. The food pantry. Unfortunately, we had no one come to pick up anything yesterday. So we're going to go at this a little differently as far as our advertising and stuff. But we do not need any more plastic bags. Thank you. We have enough. And one other thing, we do not need any more macaroni and cheese. So, okay. But otherwise, yeah, if you just want to keep continuing to give, if God doesn't see that this is something that he wants to have happen here in Stout, we will just divide the food up and bring it to the area food banks that are around the area. So, okay. I think that covers everything as far as announcements. We do have a few announcements for some prayer requests, but we'll do that during prayer time. My focus verse that I'd like us to focus on this morning comes from Psalm 119:105, and it says, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." Let's stand. Let's focus on that as we pray to God. Father, indeed, we are here to focus upon your word, the word that you have given to us. Oh, it was given many, many, many years ago, but yet it still pertains to us even today, for it never changes. Lord, as we worship you through songs and through word, and Lord, even through the very thoughts of our minds, may you be blessed in it. Lord, we just pray this all in your Son's name. Amen. Our hymn of praise for this morning to start off is number 33, "How Great Thou Art."
I see the sun.
let's wave to those who are unable to be with us, and then let's take a few moments to greet one another as well. So, morning, 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 morning. Hey, Lindy, are you live or are you on? You're on tape. Okay. Just wanted to make sure. I thought so, but I saw the piano was open and I thought, yeah, maybe. All right, kids, if you want to come up, got something to show you. Is Grandpa like a magnet? You guys stay really close, which that's good, okay? I'm not saying anything bad about that, but you hang pretty tight with him. Does he spoil you at all? How about Grandma? Does she spoil you? Yeah. All right, well, I've got something today I brought along. Anybody know what this is? Yeah, Bradley. It's dish soap, okay? Now, you guys are a little small. Briley, do you ever have to help with the dishes? Do you have a dishwasher? Can you answer me this question about a dishwasher? I do not understand this at all. We eat supper, okay, and I take the plate, and I'm going to put it in the dishwasher. And Gwen says, no, 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 no. You've got to clean it off first. If we have to clean it off first, why do we have a dishwasher? I do not understand that, okay, but that's beside the point. But used before dishwashers, we did dishes the old-fashioned way. Soap, we put it in the sink, and we did dishes. And by the time we got done, especially us guys, we had what we called dishpan hands, okay? And they were kind of creepy. They were shriveled up like a raisin almost, all right? But they got really white, okay? And today we're going to talk a little bit about Jonah and how being inside that big fish, what that did to his skin, okay? But more what it did to his inside because it changed him inwardly as well. So we're going to talk more about that, okay? Okay, let's pray and then I got some snacks for you. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord. We thank you that we have food to eat, that we have dishes to put that food on. And yes, Lord, we even thank you for having to do the dishes. We just pray, Lord, that you will help these young people as they grow, that you will change them inside more and more every day to love you. We thank you for all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Yeah. Sorry, Grandpa. What? He says. Just. There you go. Don't let the kids see that. That was a little bit different than trying to give you guys more healthy snacks. All right. All right. At this time, Lindy has prepared a special number for us, so thank you for that.
Thank you.
If you have the little insert that Tammy put in the bulletin with the words of Glorious Day, look, take a look at that this morning. Thank you, Lindy, by the way. This preacher man needed that song really badly, okay? Verse 1, one day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men. My example is he. The word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. And then skip down to that last verse. One day the trumpet will sound for his coming, one day the skies with his glory will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one bringing, my Savior Jesus is mine. If you take nothing else out of the service this morning, remember that. We think it's bad now, don't we? And it is, don't get me wrong, sin is running rampant. But sin has been running rampant since Adam and Eve. And God sent a solution. But his work isn't complete yet, and because of that, we still have to go through what we're going through, even in our very lives and in the lives of our friends, our family, our country, our world. But Jesus is coming back. People ask, you know, how long is that going to be? Is COVID a sign of the times, of the end times? And I say, well, I don't know when Jesus is coming back, and I don't really know if COVID is a sign or not. But what I do know is since COVID has reared up, we've been roughly 2 years, okay, from the very first case. And what I do know is that we're 2 years closer than we were back then. Let's pray. Father, indeed, it will be a glorious day when you return. And Lord, as your believers, we look forward to that. But Lord, we also know that in the meantime, there is a job for us to do. You have given us a mission. And you have asked, no, you have commanded that we would go out and share what we know, what we believe with the world around us, even sometimes when we don't think they deserve it. Lord, as we read again from Jonah this morning and learn more about him and how you worked through him, Lord, may you do the same in our very lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Our scripture this morning is from Jonah chapter 3, and it's found on page 1438 in your pew Bibles if you'd like to follow along. And if you remember last week when we ended up, the big fish, the whale, if you will, had just spit Jonah up onto dry land. And now we pick up in chapter 3. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message I give you. Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord and went to Nineveh. Now Nineveh was a very large city, and it took 3 days to go through it. Jonah began by going a day's journey into the city, proclaiming, 40 more days and Nineveh will be overthrown. The Ninevites believed God. A fast was proclaimed, and all of them, from the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth. When Jonah's warning reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, took off his royal robes, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat down in the dust. This is the proclamation he issued in Nineveh. By the decree of the king and his nobles, do not let people or animals, herds or flocks, taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink. But the people and the animals are covered with sackcloth. Let everyone call urgently upon God. Let them give up their evil ways and their violence. Who knows? God might yet relent and show compassion and turn from his fierce anger so that we will not perish. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction that he had threatened. The word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God. As I mentioned before we started reading the scripture last week, we ended with Jonah being spit up onto dry land after being in the belly of that fish for 3 days. Many scholars speculate, and with good reason, that Jonah's skin is now bleach white. that his skin has shriveled up, that he probably did not look anything like he did before he went in to the belly of that fish. And I want you to remember that, because we're going to talk a little more about Jonah next week, but keep that thought in your mind, how Jonah's appearance is what his skin is like, because it's going to play an important role in next week's lesson. God had transformed Jonah. Outwardly, yes, by his appearance, but inwardly as well. The story that we started with in Jonah chapter 1 began with a tragedy, and it wasn't the storm. It was the fact that Jonah was running away from God. And a greater tragedy would have been if God would have left Noah or Jonah run. See, that is a theme that we see in God's Word over and over and over and over again. Man runs from God, man leaves God for whatever reason, and God goes back and searches for them. He did it with Adam and Eve. When they had sinned, he went, he sought them out. When Cain killed Abel, he went to Cain and said, "What have you done? What's going on?" Jesus himself in the New Testament tells these parables of a lost sheep, how he'll leave 99 good sheep behind to go find one who strayed away. Our God is a God of second chances. Those of you who are golfers, you might say he gives us mulligans. God worked through Jonah, even in his disobedience. Because of his disobedience, he was on that ship. And because he was on that ship, those sailors who saw what was happening and listened to what Jonah had to say were saved. And now God comes to Jonah this second time and he says, go to that city of Nineveh like I had told you. But this time he adds this to his command and proclaim the message that I give you. Jonah was to preach only what God had told him, no more, no less. Not to sugarcoat it or water it down, but to give this message of doom and destruction to one of the most powerful cities in the world. You might say God sent someone from the Reformed Church of Stout to Washington, D.C. to shake things up a bit. We read in other places that Nineveh's walls were 8 miles in circumference, that over 175,000 people lived there, and as men were counted in those days, or people were counted in those days, those were probably just the men. There were no women or children involved or added to that number. We read that the administrative district, the government district, was 30 miles across by itself. It took 3 days for Jonah to get through that city. Everyone needed to be reached. Every last soul needed to be reached. And God's word was and is today for everyone. No matter how wicked, no matter how powerful, all must be taught or shared the good news of Jesus Christ. But with this warning, with this proclamation, with this good news, there was also a limitation, a warning. God gave that city 40 days to shape up. 40 days. Where have we heard that before? The people of Nineveh knew, I repeat, knew the story of the great flood. That story that happened to mankind went through the world after Noah had set his feet on dry ground and had started to repopulate the earth. It went throughout the world. Not everybody believed in that God, our God, but yet the story was proclaimed and everyone knew it. And every time that phrase 40 days was brought up, it spurred some interest in whoever heard it. You see, they knew that God's judgment was real, that God would come through with whatever he had proclaimed. Jesus even made a reference of it in Matthew 12, verse 39 through 41. And he said this, that the judgment of men of Nineveh will stand up to condemn the Israelites. God's very own people refused to accept and believe what God was trying to show them. And God, through Jesus, said, you know what? The people of Nineveh got it and my own people don't. And it was a sad time for the Israelites. But these people, the people of Nineveh, they responded with fasting, with wearing sackcloth, which was a sign of being in reverence to someone or something. They sat in dust. But it just amazes me that Jonah went to the people, the common folks, first, before he went to the king. And I believe that that is in our message or in our text this morning for a reason. I believe we as Christians need to start at the bottom and work up when we're sharing the good news. And that does not sit well in our Western culture mind, does it? How many of you, and you don't need to raise your hands, you can if you want to, how many of you think we need to change America by starting at the top? And I'm not saying by changing the party that's in charge. I'm not saying that. How many of you think we need to go to the top rung of the ladder and start sharing the good news with them people, beating some sense into them, and letting them understand what's going on, and maybe if they get it, they can straighten this country out? God doesn't work that way. God says, I want you to go into the alleys, the poor people, the people that everyone looks down upon. I want you to start with those people and share the good news. When Jonah did that, Jonah did not have to go to the king by himself. Jonah had a throng of believers with him. There is power in numbers, and Jonah realized that. And so when he went to the king, he did not have to fear. He went with confidence. And I love the response of the king. He says to everyone who wasn't, obeying, I guess, the words that Jonah had told the people, that they needed to obey, that they needed to focus, that they needed to fast, that they needed to sit in sackcloth in the dust, to show that they were turning from their evil ways. And the king says, who knows? Maybe it'll work. The king wasn't totally sold. But what harm could it do? Because I know that God that said 40 days means 40 days. Are you a who knows Christian this morning? I've heard people say something to this effect. I don't know if everything in the Bible is true. I don't know if everything that God teaches in His Word is actually going to happen. I don't even really know if there's a heaven and a hell for sure. But I'm going to believe this anyway, just in case. I'm going to hedge my bet. So that way, if everything is true in the Bible, then I'm on the right side. And if everything that we read in the Bible, if it's a farce, then, well, I'm really not out much. I believe there are many, many who knows Christians out there today. People who are along for the ride. People who just want to make sure that if it comes to the very worst, they're covered. And they're missing out. They're missing out on so, so many blessings that having faith in Jesus Christ brings upon this earth. Their faith, if you will, is not a faith. It is more of a cop-out. God did spare Nineveh. He wants to save you and me and everyone else that's in this world His way. In verse 10, we read, when God saw what they did, the Ninevites, how they turned did an about face from their evil ways. He had compassion on them and did not bring them into the destruction that he had threatened. That is the God we serve. We do not serve a God who sits up on his throne with a crown, with his arms crossed, looking down at this earth going. He doesn't do that. That is not the God that we serve. That is not the demeanor of the God that we know. Yes, our God is solidly based upon his word and what he has given us. And he will never vary from that. He will be consistent in that all the time. Our God has integrity. What he says is true. But our God also is a God of love. It was for that reason that he sent Jesus into the world when it was filled with black sin. It is for that reason that Jesus is going to come again. That he is going to set this world in a proper manner. It was the faith of the Ninevites that saved them. It was the faith that those sailors had on that boat that saved them. It is that same faith, that same God of salvation that gave Jonah that second chance. It is that God that we serve today. Are you running from God? Oh, maybe you're not running, but maybe God has let you know that there's a job that he wants you to do. Are you coming up with excuses? Are you saying to God, I'm not good enough, I do not have the right words, I am too busy, I. Ladies and gentlemen, that is not the basis of the Reformed Church in America, right? That I has nothing to do with it. It is all about God. Do we share boldly the word that God has given to us? Do we not add any sugar coating to it? Do we dilute it down by just leaving out the parts that maybe we don't like? Do we believe that it is important, that it is essential that we tell this to everyone, even to those people who we think are not worthy? Do we believe everything that God has offered us through his Son, Jesus Christ? And do we live it out, or are we stubborn like the Israelites? Do we respond like so often in the Bible the outsiders did? Do we repent and do we turn to God? Do we seek his compassion? This week, I would like you to do some self-reflection on your life. I want you to look back as far as you can remember back into your life, okay? And when I'm saying this, I'm not saying about that you had to walk uphill both ways to school each morning. I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about how deep the snow got back in 36 or whatever year you want. I want you to reflect upon your own walk with Jesus Christ. As far back as you can remember. And I want you to look closely at how many times Jesus or God himself, however you want to look at it, came to you seeking you out. He never gave up on you, obviously, or you wouldn't be here this morning. I want you to reflect. I want you to remember the times when you failed God miserably. And then next week, as Paul Harvey would say, we're going to have the rest of the story. Because how you look upon your own life, your own walk with God, with Jesus Christ, how you look at yourself, even now, as a person, is going to determine a whole lot upon how effective you and I are going to be in proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ. And I'm going to leave it right there because I don't want to spill the beans about next week. So this week, let's reflect, let's pray. Father, indeed, you have given us second and third and fourth and fifth and umpteen thousand chances. Lord, you did it with your very own people. We read in the Word how you would warn them and they'd come back to you and then they would fade away. And Lord, you know that is our sinful nature, but yet you come back. Lord, may we remember that. May we never forget that. And especially as we go out to share the good news that you have given us. Because the people that we are going to go to are just like that. They're not perfect. They've messed up. And Lord, I think if you would change our hearts, if you would change at the way we look, even at our own lives, you will help us to better understand how we are to face those people that you have put in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Our hymn of application, number 481, Where He Leads, I'll Follow. I have some prayer concerns to pass your way before I ask from you guys anything that you have to pray for. I was informed beforehand that Leon Meester passed away very suddenly, so please be with the Meester family as they are definitely shocked, I'm sure, by all this and as they go through this time. Also, you've probably heard that COVID is getting revved up a little bit again. Ray Hemmen, Hemmer and Gary Abbas, I assume, right? That's who you're talking about. They both have it. So, and I know a few other people that also do. So let's be in prayer for those who have contracted COVID again. Continue to be with those or pray for those who are struggling with cancer and going through those treatments and all the things that go along with that. Continue to pray for Harvey and his leg. We praise God that he was able to celebrate his birthday yesterday and that he likes M. Farmalls or Super M. Farmalls. So. I had to get you at that a little bit, Roger. All right. And we'll continue to pray with for those who have lost loved ones in accidents recently. And we do thank God for the rain that he has given us. And again, we were reminded this morning that some have received quite a bit, and some of us up north don't get quite so much. So we'll continue to pray that God will bless us with more showers. Does anyone have anything else? Yeah, Mary. Okay. 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 Yeah, definitely. So, Florianne's aunt passed away recently, and also she found out that her cousin who was doing cancer treatments has decided to stop that. So, be with her. I saw another hand here somewhere. And maybe not. Oh, yeah, there's Roger. So remember the Everts family as well, as they've lost a loved one. Yeah, Ken, or are you going to tell me about Kenny? Is that what? Yeah. Okay. 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 Awesome. So Kenny DeFreeze is back in the hospital with pneumonia. And for a long time, our prayer group has been praying for a little girl named Evie who has cancer. We praise God that right now her numbers are good and she's doing better. So anything else? Yeah, Dave. Okay. Okay. Wow. So one of Dave's co-workers, Dave, or Dean, is on a ventilator with COVID. Okay. Anything else? Yeah.
Kenny DeFreeze's granddaughter was in a severe accident, I guess.
Okay.
Haley was in a bad accident, hit a gravel truck at Iowa City. It's Pam and Pam's daughter.
Okay. So Kenny's granddaughter was in a bad car accident. Yeah. Right, yeah, so if you don't know who Leon is, his son bought out Randy, so a connection there. Anything else? If not, let's come before our Father in prayer. Father, we just thank you for hearing us when we come to you. Lord, we thank you for the many blessings that you give us each and every day, those things that we would say money can't buy. We do thank you, Lord, for the rain that you have given. Lord, you know that some have not received as much and that we all still do need more. So, Lord, we leave it in your hands, but we praise you for being a God that takes care of your earth and of us. Lord, there are many that need you in a special way, many that we know personally. Lord, we just pray that you would be with the Meester family and the Everts family. Pray that you will continue to be with the Kaufman family and the Sanderson family as they all are mourning the loss of loved ones, as well as Florianne in the loss of her aunt. Lord, we just pray that you will give comfort and peace to them. Lord, we pray for those that need you in a special way because of health concerns. Lord, we just pray for those who are continuing to struggle with cancer and with the treatments that go along with it, Lord. We just pray that you would be with Florianne's cousin, Lord, and just bless that family as they have decided to stop treatments. Lord, we pray, too, that you'll be with Kenny DeVries, Lord. Just be with him. Lord, I just pray that you would draw him closer and closer to you. We pray for his granddaughter, Lord, who was in a severe accident. We just pray that whatever her situation may be, that you will heal her, Lord, and bring her back to good health. And Lord, too, we know that the COVID is making a return and that many people are being affected with it. Lord, we think of Ray and of Gary, Lord, and others who maybe have just a mild case of it. We just pray that you will heal their bodies. But Lord, we think especially of Dean this morning. Lord, as he is on a ventilator, we pray, Lord, that the medicines and the treatments that they are giving him would be effective and that he again would be healed. Lord, it's hard to believe, it's hard to imagine, but school is just about ready to start again for another year. Lord, we pray for our children and our teachers as they go back. Lord, may they learn well. Lord, may you protect them not only from COVID, but from so many things that could harm them. We put them in the hollow of your hand, and we trust that you will see it through. Lord, we thank you that Harvey was able to celebrate his 103rd birthday. We thank you for him and for Carrie, for Eunice, for Linda, for Lois, for others, Lord, that may not be able to worship with us, but yet they love you dearly. We thank you for that. And Lord, again this morning, we thank you for the United States of America. Lord, we thank you for the freedoms we have here. Lord, we pray that you will be with our leaders. Lord, that you would guide them, that you would instill that light of your word upon their paths and that they may lead us well. We thank you, Lord, for being with this country so many years, for bringing us through good times and bad times. And Lord, we thank you especially for them bad times when it involved force. We thank you for our veterans, for those who served, and for those who continue to serve. Lord, we see that we too are in a war with Satan. Lord, may we be your warriors. May you lead us, Lord, out into the world around us. May we understand that we have a great mission to accomplish. For Lord, we know that you're coming back. Lord, that no one knows when that is, but Lord, it could be at any time. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for all he has done for us. Thank you, Lord, for that second chance that you give us through him. And Lord, we thank you for that prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, let's stand for our doxology and offertory prayer in thanking God for what he has given us. Let's stand. Father, you indeed have blessed us so richly. As we return now a portion of what you have given us, may you bless these offerings. I pray too, Lord, that you will bless the gifts to the food pantry. Lord, I just pray that you will send people who need some assistance to take advantage of the grace, the love, and the generosity that we have shown. Lord, we thank you for all these things, realizing that they all do come from you. In Jesus' name, amen. Before we have the last hymn, I do want to tell you, our first food bank day was yesterday, and we unfortunately had nobody come. So if you'd be praying for that as we continue on, if you have an idea on how we can get the word out better, if you have some friends that you think might want to come or need to come, if you'd let them know, that would be wonderful. Also, there are some tomatoes and some cucumbers and maybe a few green beans that somebody gave that we were going to hand out yesterday that are in the basement. If you can use any of them, please take them because they're not going to be any good and the next time we're opened up. So, all right, let's close with our closing hymn, "It's All Because of God's Amazing Grace," number 354. Hear God's benediction, and now may the Lord watch between me and thee, while we are absent one from the other. And all God's people said, Amen. Our closing chorus, the first verse of Amazing Grace.